Rastafari. Shalom. This is Wyndham Alonzo, the Lion of the Tribe of Judah Society. We about to go forward into Rastafari Senbet Shabbat study number 17. In the English, Jethro, Ibrahist Kwankwa, which is in the Hebrew language, we have Yethro, and Amarin in Amharic, we have Yotor. Now, very significant, Yotor, the father of Zipporah, the wife of Moses, which bore him two children, Gershom and Eleazar. And so, Zipporah, also noteworthy in Ethiopian. Now, six sisters, seven in total. Most likely, due to tradition, the eldest of the seven sisters, taking the hand of a prince coming out of Egypt, stretching forth her hands to a prince that comes out of Egypt in the form of Moses. And we have a quite interesting relationship to the latter-day fulfillment of Queen Makeda of Sheba of Ethiopia, you know, a queen of seven. And her coming together with Solomon of Jerusalem, you know, and thus through the Holy Spirit bringing forth Menelik the first, David the second. And so now, okay, within our Torah portion, or in the Amharic Orit Nebab, Torah reading number 17, for the New Testament reading, we are to study up on the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 5, from verses 8 to verse 20. But we're actually going to focus on the New Testament reading, except we're going to begin from Edus Mateus, Edus Ye Mateus Vangel, something to that effect, the Gospel of St. Matthew. Chapter 5, we're going to begin with verse 1. And so, we're going to be reading from the Old Schofield Study Bible. And so, let us go on. Now, title, The Sermon on the Mount, The Beatitudes. And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain. And when he was set, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So we'll go ahead and pause right there. For verse 2, which reads, And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying. That's actually, well, okay, going forward, we have a footnote for that. So we'll go forward, and that footnote will actually be the main focus of this reason, which is, you know, of much importance, significance to all humanity. And especially to those that seek truth. Now, excuse me. Having announced the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The king, in Matthew 5-7, chapters 5-7, declares the principles of the kingdom. The Sermon on the Mount has a twofold application. One, literally to the kingdom. In this sense, it gives the divine constitution for the righteous government of the earth. Whenever the kingdom of heaven is established on earth, it will be according to that constitution, which may be regarded as an explanation of the word righteousness, as used by the prophets in describing the kingdom. In this sense, the Sermon on the Mount is pure law, and transfers the offense from the overt act to the motive. Here lies the deeper reason why the Jews rejected the kingdom. They had reduced righteousness to mere ceremonialism, and the Old Testament idea of the kingdom to a mere affair of outward splendor and power. They were never rebuked for expecting a visible and powerful kingdom, but the words of the prophets should have prepared them to expect also that only the poor in spirit and the meek could share in it. Excuse me. We actually don't... we're not too quite sure what to think of poor in spirit. For we were under the impression that the poor, excuse me, okay, so we have, yeah, the poor in spirit, you know, change of plans. For some reason, we discredit what it sounds to be when it is said poor in spirit. We're sure we'll have to double check that, but spirit in this case, we're pretty sure has nothing to do with spirit as in Holy Spirit, as in we can't even explain it because we haven't even studied that, but we're pretty sure that that word spirit probably has something to do with something other than what we mostly all the time recognize as spirit. Excuse you for that. We overlooked that, but nonetheless, we'll keep that for further study, and the meek could share in it. Now, the 70. Well, first. Well, we'll go forward and make mention that there's a kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God. And although we're not all that well learned in their full details, we know that there is a kingdom of God on earth, and there is a heavenly kingdom. Now, you know, we personally ourselves may have oftentimes confused one or the other, but to keep from that confusion, we'll go forward and say that the kingdom of God upon the earth, on which the Davidic dynasty lies, is Ethiopia. And we'll keep to that the heavenly kingdom is this new age, which Our Majesty, Father Majesty, Ababa John Hoy, hath welcomed, and we Rastafari are greeting, you know, and thus forewarning the peoples of that which is to come, which is truth. And, you know, all glory be to His Majesty Most High, and through Jesus Christos. And so, so Ethiopia, the kingdom of which the throne of David lies, a real kingdom upon earth. A lot of people are expecting this to just be randomly, just in by the clap of some hands, be magically made manifest. A kingdom does not just happen like that. A kingdom takes time, and it is at hand. Now, that kingdom, we here do testify that has come to an end, and has been given into the hand of I and I as children of the Most High, Rastafari. And so, that kingdom that was at hand, that even Jesus testified to, is Ethiopia. And now that power has been transferred over into the hands of us Rastafari, into the heavenly kingdom, a kingdom in which it is governed by the eyes of heaven, which is governed by the rule of God Almighty, and not by the corruption of man. And so, we just had to throw that out there, put that forward, because for whatever reason. So now, going forward, the 72nd Psalm, which was universally received by them as a description of the kingdom, was full of this. For these reasons, the Sermon on the Mount, in its primary application, gives neither the privilege nor the duty of the church. Okay, we give thanks to the Most High God, Jah Rastafari, you know, in the manifest edus. It kind of came to mind what we were even thinking about earlier. This kingdom is twofold. It's very visible and very real, but still it is very invisible and very surreal. What we mean to say is that, it is established on the earth. Anyone can research the Davidic house of the Davidic dynasty set up in Ethiopia through Solomon and Sheba. It's very real. Haile Selassie I, the first and the last king of kings of Ethiopia, to sit upon the throne of David. It is very visible, very real, but still the world cannot see it because of the motive. See, people live in darkness, for their heart hath not been pure, and so they cannot see anything good coming out of Galilee of the nations, not Galilee. If we go back to Isaiah, it is said Galilee of the nations, of the League of Nations, of all nations, of the United Nations, Ethiopia, this Galilee, this modern day Galilee, which people refuse to accept to be anything other than gibberish or nonsense or of no significance. And so with that comes the blindedness of humanity in their inability of witnessing what they do see, but they cannot see. For the transfer of power comes in the form of accepting that kingdom, and thus rising above humanity and entering into the heavenly kingdom, in which all men are created equal, and thus by accepting what is to be, for none else can be, proving yourself worthy of partaking forming part in what the Almighty has in mind for us to make manifest, which is the coming together of all peoples with no discrimination, with no prejudice, just accepting all humanity for what it is, a creation of the Almighty, and thus helping each other to understand this. And so those that cannot see Ethiopia as anything other than a place of a poor place, a poor kingdom, a poor, just that don't even consider it, have failed to make manifest a pure heart, you know, for their prejudice, discrimination, racism, for whatever reasons, you know. And so this is a test. This in itself is a judgment that we are confronted with today, you know. And it's it's genius. So let's go forward. So now it reads, "For these reasons, the Sermon on the Mount, in its primary application, gives neither the privilege nor the duty to the church." So this is outside of the church. Now, these are found in the epistle. Now, continuing, "Under the law of the kingdom, for example, no one may hope for forgiveness who has not first forgiven. Under grace, the Christian is exhorted to forgive because he is already forgiven." Okay, so actually our main focus is Psalm 72, and for obvious reasons. We'll go forward to that, but let us continue reading the whole reading within Torah portion, Orit Nebab, number 17, Yotor, Yethro, Jethro. We'll begin from verse 1 once more, so that we could get like a better comprehension or understanding of and significance and point out these details that come very much alive when put into a proper perspective. Now, "And seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain. And when he was set..." So now, if we go forward to the book of Exodus, this is the coming out of Egypt in its fullness. You see, first you must come out of Egypt. You must come out of all this religious confusion, Babel, corruption, out of far from any contact or proximity to any of the corruption which is this world. You must step outside into the wilderness, into the desert, into a arid land, a land not inhabited by those that have already been corrupted, for we've all been corrupted, born in sin, coming out into, you know, even, we could even say, going out into nature, into the wild, where at least all is natural, and thus not so much corrupted and sinful, except for iodized selves, but in a, you know, not influenced by any negative and corrupt ideas, you know, allows us the freedom and liberty of accepting truth. So now, coming out, and this is what it is, you know, so this is what is being described here. And so, seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain. So now, actually, in this verse, Jesus has already came out of the cities. He's not in the synagogues. He's not within the towns and stuff like that. So now that you're away from all the religious confusion, which only leads to delusion, now he goes up into a mountain. Now not only do we have to separate ourselves from the flesh and the worldly corruption, but now we have to rise above and become bigger than we have ever been. You know, we must reach a higher mind. And so it is well represented by Jesus going up into a mountain. And when he was set and established and accepted and erected, exalted, his disciples came to him. Those that were willing came to him. Blessed are the poor in spirit. This even reminds us of Old Testament Exodus, in the case where Moses goes up and the people just want to stay down there. You know, but even though in Exodus it is only Moses that comes up, we as Rastafari are as Moses. We are a Moses type. Each one, there is a Moses type art. There's a Moses within each Rastafari, because we see God. We know God. No one else in the world has God as we do in such a close relationship. And so it is our duty to show God to people, for they are not willing or able or worthy for whatever reason, you know. God showed mercy or grace to whom he showed mercy, you know. And so we be as Moses. So now, going forward, so that we don't, you know, spend too much time here. So his disciples came to him. So you must leave the corruption, which is the multitudes in the cities, going to the wilderness. Then you must rise above to a higher mind, an elevated way of thinking, a heavenly form or a heavenly way of meditating, contemplating, thinking, accepting, receiving. And so now, and he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, interesting, for this is one who opened not his mouth to certain peoples, you know, and to whom it is given, you know, Israel boy, Shema Israel, listen, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. You know, this reminds us of us. We had no spirit. Blessed are they that mourn. We cried out to the Almighty, to anything, because we despised this existence. It is dreadful. It's been pain since the moment we can remember that we were conscious and able to think and remember that which we were doing. You know, since a very young age, we've had nothing but a horrible time within this world system. Our whole experience was one of mourning until we cried out into if anything we ever did that was pure was the pain that came from the mourning, from the cry that we made manifest, and Jah, you know, blessed be him, give thanks to the Almighty, did listen, you know. And so, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. You know, we only have one individual that can testify to this, probably others, but we know for a fact that this particular individual does remember and can testify to what we are about to say. We've always been into trouble and stuff like that, problems with authority and stuff like that, but we did not know much about what it is that we wanted, but we would always say, and this individual could testify to it, a certain individual, you know, makes no difference, one's probably will never hear his testimony, but it'd be interesting to get it on camera. So nonetheless, we used to say, like we don't care what had gone with I and I, you know, what happened to I and I, but we would actually like to be like Albert Einstein type, you know, some type of person that comes up with solutions to problems in this world. You know, we wanted to be a type that answered questions never before answered and stuff like that. And behold, Rastafari, you know, give thanks and praises. So that in a sense is our personal experience as far as seeking after righteousness. Maybe we weren't all that into Jesus, the white Christ, or into Christianity, the deception and stuff like that. But we did know that we wanted to do something to help humanity and to make it easier for us to live, you know, be it our personal experience and the dread of having to wake up every day and live in this chaos. So now going forward, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely. For my sake, rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light to all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. What Christian can testify to this? They don't have a father. Rastafari have a father. In Germanic Edamawi Haile Selassie, you know, the conquering line of the tribe of Judah, elect of God, King of Kings of Ethiopia, called of him to serve his son, Jesus Christos, Yeshua HaMashiach. And so, all we do is serve our brother, his son, Metchanit Achin, our Savior. You know, and by doing thus, automatically our Father becometh glorified, for who called us to serve the Son but none other than the Father, you know, his imperial majesty. So now, going forward, relation of Christ to the law. Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy but to fulfill. For verily I say to you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say to you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. And that's where the Torah portion, Orit Nibab, number 17, concludes. Interesting. So it begins with the kingdom attributed to the poor in spirit. You know, the relationship with God, thus eventually glorifying the Father through the Son, is given to those of a pure heart, and it concludes with unless our righteousness, which is Jesus Christos, exceed the righteousness, which is unbelief of the Pharisees and scribes, you know, their righteousness is of unbelief, and for unbelief. You know, in the book of Hebrews, it explains it perfectly. You know, those that perish perish for lack of faith, because of unbelief. You know, in the wilderness, the fathers, it was the children of Israel, you know, because they had faith and believed. But the other generation passed away. And so now let's go forward to Psalm 72. And another thing we forgot even to mention is that within Psalm 72 we have the description, which is universally accepted by all Jews that say they are, and you know, do err in not receiving the Holy Spirit and the manifestation of things that are to be, which they can be nothing else. You know, those that say they are, they accept Psalm 72 to be a description of the kingdom, but their unbelief prevents them from accepting that kingdom or even seeing that kingdom. You know, so now, well, the description goes into how this kingdom will be a poor kingdom. It, you know, all throughout the scriptures, it's a poor kingdom. It's not a world powerhouse. It's not like this kingdom has never been described within the prophets as a kingdom for instance, a United States, in which it is a world power. No, this kingdom has always been described as meek and humble and poor in certain ways, poor of certain characteristics, and abundantly rich in others. So now, a psalm for Solomon, concerning Solomon. Give the king thy judgments, O God. So judgment to the father, to the king of kings of Ethiopia, and thy righteousness to the king's son. Gitachin Jesus Christos. That is a whole other reasoning, and we'll come forward with that. It'll open way to the ignorance to within all Christianity to flee, you know, from mind eye and come into the comprehending, the understanding of those things which have been made manifest, and we Rastafari do clearly and perfectly accurately testify to. Look forward for that. Now, he shall judge thy people with righteousness and thy poor with judgment. The mountains shall bring peace to the people and the little hills by righteousness. This could even be kind of like, mountains shall bring peace to the people, in the sense that it wasn't governments, mountains, government powers. It wasn't just Ethiopian the warriors that defeated, you know, that old serpent, the devil, the Vatican Roman supposed empire. Our Father Majesty had a lot of help from many nations. So mountains did bring peace, help to bring peace. He shall judge the poor of the people. He shall save the children of the needy. He shall break in pieces the oppressor. This is very, very, actually, very enlightening, in the sense that there is a psalm in which reeds and Leviathan was given to the Ethiopians. And we're not going to go forward to that because we kind of, okay, give thanks to the Most High God, Jah Rastafari. It's Psalm 74, and it's verse 14. It reads, "Thou breakest the heads of Leviathan in pieces, and gavest him to be meat to the people inhabiting the wilderness." But correctly, it says, "To the people inhabiting Ethiopia, to the Ethiopians, Le Ethiopia," is what it should rightfully say. And the wilderness, the coming out of the corruption and the cities, and coming up out of confusion, and then climbing up into the highlands, the roof of Africa, the holy mountains, you know, and so on and so forth. But going forward, we're not gonna, well, might as well. Okay, so Psalm 74. Give me just 1 second, or maybe a minute. Psalm 74, verse 14. It reads, excuse me. Okay, we know it. Anten Yezenton Rasochink et Le Ethiopia Sewochin Megbachin Set a Hacho. And so we'll actually see if it could be seen eyefully. It's kind of small, but we'll see if I'm... Well, I'm not too sure how visible that'll come out, but Ethiopia is right there. Ethiopia. So that kind of very well ties into this, to Psalm 72. And so going forward, it reads, and shall break in pieces the oppressor. Also, you know, well, we're not, let's go forward. They shall fear thee as long as the sun and moon endure throughout all generations. He shall come down like rain upon the mown grass, as showers that water the earth. In his days shall the righteous flourish, and abundance of peace, so long as the moon endureth. He shall have dominion also from sea to sea, and from river, and from the river to the ends of the earth. The river, what river? Oftentimes it's the Nile River. Most of the times, you know, from beyond the rivers of Ethiopia. And so this kingdom is not only describing a real kingdom, but a surreal kingdom. Why? Because this King of Kings has dominion over the world, the earth, you know, earth rightful ruler. Because a rain is not only a physical, geographical boundary, limitations, or certain area of territory, but it is the rain within the minds, a rulership over people, you know. And so going forward, we can't really explain that all that well right now. But nonetheless, it is very, very much so, you know. And to whom I am emperor, says His Majesty, to whom I am emperor. If we were to keep the commandments, then His Majesty our Father, would not only we kind of forgot that answer, would not only accept us to be historically Christian, but also actively Christian. You know, so His Majesty is well aware of what He set in place and how everything is set up for us Rastafari to do that which we be doing and go forward with it. You know, His Majesty did not set physical geographical boundaries to the rule, to the rulership of the Rastafari, of the head, the Ras to revere, to reverence. So now going forward, now we left off on verse 8. So now verse 9. They that dwell in Ethiopia shall bow before him. You know, King James Version reads, they that dwell in the wilderness shall bow before him. But correctly it should say, they that dwell in Ethiopia, Ethiopians shall bow before him. Now we have that it also in the Metahaf Eduz, the Book of the Seven Seals, Behitun Ethiopia Yisegdalu Telat Ochum Afer Yilsalu, you know, before him, in front of him, Ethiopia shall prostrate, and the enemy, the dirt shall lick. So now, we'll get a glimpse of that. Let's see. It's kind of small, but okay, over here. Befitun Ethiopia Yisigdalu Telatochum Afer Yilsalu. And so now, and further evidence of that, and why it is of great significance and importance. Now see, if those that say they're Jews accept this to be a description of the kingdom, then this is pretty much all that is required to accept, to legitimize the throne, the house of David, the tent of David in Ethiopia, you know, the tents of Tushan. So now, in the Spanish Bible, we have here, okay, we have delante de él se postrarán los, and then what does it say there? Ethiopies. So that is pretty clear. Los Ethiopies, the Ethiopians, shall bow before him. You know? Before whom? Before the King of Kings, before His Majesty. So now it reads, the kings of Tarshish and the isles shall bring presents. What? So if this is such a glorious kingdom, which it really is, why would people bring gifts? Why would they need other peoples to bring gifts and presents and stuff like that? Because it is a poor kingdom in certain ways. A kingdom that, you know, testified to the things that were and still are. So a kingdom living in a lifestyle, a form of life, that which was lived during the times of Christ Jesus. Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christos. And so, that kind of poor, you know, not technologically advanced and stuff like that. So yes, all of the world brought presents to Ethiopia during the coronation of His Majesty. You know, there's a paper clip, a newspaper clipping that reads that the diplomats that were sent it reads something like, send more presents to the king or to the emperor of Ethiopia. You know, and then it reads like the diplomats, we're assuming the American diplomats sent were tired after so many days of festivities and celebration. And so, you know, this is very real. Over 50 nations presented themselves during the coronation, and brought gifts. And during World War II, you know, a lot of nations helped. And after, you know, the Swedish brought this, the Russians brought that. Well, we don't want to get into what the Russians brought, right? But the Americans brought this, the British brought that, and so this is as real as it gets. You know, and so going forward, and even there's a we'll see if we could open that up right here. There's a kind of like a, it's President Eisenhower of the United States of America, and he sends like a, okay, here it is. It actually says released November 3rd, 1955, dated November 2nd, 1955. His Imperial Majesty Haile Selassie, first Emperor of Ethiopia, Addis Ababa. The people of the United States join with me today in extending to your Imperial Majesty heartiest congratulations on the 25th anniversary of your accession to the throne, and in sending best wishes for your continued health and happiness. On this significant occasion, it is gratifying to see the fulfillment of the confidence expressed by this government, by the United States of American government, at the time of your coronation. Under your reign, the traditional ties of friendship and mutual understanding between our two countries, as well as the sympathetic cooperation of our peoples, have indeed been strengthened, and I'm confident that the mutual aspirations of our peoples will further enhance this relationship in the years to come. President Dwight D. Eisenhower. So very, very well recognized that the United States placed its confidence in that this coronation, this new ruler of rulers would succeed in bringing about a long-term reign of righteousness. So now, just to conclude, so the kings of Tarshish and of the Isles shall bring presents, the kings of Sheba and Seba shall offer gifts, yea, all kings shall fall down before him, all nations shall serve him. Some brought, you know, hospital doctors, some brought, you know, professors, some brought technology, some brought money. But the world, everyone wanted to take part in this miracle that was Ethiopia, that is Ethiopia, you know. Everyone wanted to be a part of the reign and empire of His Majesty, you know. This, you know, seemingly fairy tale come to life. This romance, you know, manifested in truth and in reality. So now going forward, it reads, for he shall deliver the needy when he crieth, the poor also, and him that hath no helper. His Majesty is he who with his very mouth, with the mouth and of the mighty God himself, declared those things that need to be declared and brought liberty to all peoples. Without His Majesty, we as black peoples of this world would not be able to stand here today and raise our voices, you know, on high, and declare, and require, and demand those liberties that are rightly and justly attributed to us as children of the Most High, as creatures of the Creator, you know, that's something to get into as well. But without Ethiopia, there would have been no hope for any peoples in this world. Those that have been colonized would have been defeated through the colonization, and those that put into practice the act of colonizing had already been colonized by the by the deception of being granted the ability and the right to colonize. So most people enslaved through enslavement, and other people that put into practice the enslaving, enslaved by their idea of being able to enslave, you know? And eventually, evil do away with evil, and they too would have perished. But Ethiopia was kept pure and clean and separate. Freedom since the beginning, so that we could testify that man is equal, regardless of the color of his skin. And that man is equal, regardless of the social status or economic wealth that he may possess. So, but that's a whole different reasoning in itself, so let's go forward. Now, it reads, "He shall spare the poor and needy, and shall save the souls of the needy. He shall redeem their soul from deceit and violence, and precious shall their blood be in his sight, and he shall live, and to him shall be given of the gold of Sheba. Prayer also shall be made for him continually, and daily shall he be praised." There, you know, Rastafari. "There shall be an handful of corn in the earth, the top of the mountains. The fruit thereof shall shake like Lebanon. And they of the city shall flourish like grass of the earth. His name shall endure forever. His name shall be continued as long as the sun. And men shall be blessed in him. All nations shall call him blessed. Blessed be the Lord God, the God of Israel, who only doeth wondrous things. And blessed be his glorious name forever. Amen. And let the whole earth be filled with his glory. Amen and amen. The prayers of David, the son of Jesse, are ended, fulfilled, accomplished. The lion of the tribe of Judah hath prevailed." You know? So you mix it up. More and best of the Emnegede Yehuda. Negusenegest ze Ethiopia. You know? In and through Jesus Christos. Alright, to conclude, well, might as well conclude with the reading of this mezmur. So now, Sle Salomon, Abit Fetichne Lingusis Edik Echnum Lingusilij Isabechne Bet Edik Egrinuch Echnum Befred Yetanyan Zend Terra Rojna Kiritoch Elizabeth Salamne Yik Ebelu Lich Grainuch Isabeth Edik Eferdale Yet one yet hochnum lejoch at nalik kefunum tawar de walik a high yen norbet zemen hulu which eric am fit elefit lelich lich yen ral in the zinab bit arch ede meski lie bemitrim lie in the meat about it. Et ayewertal, bezemenun tedik yebebal, cherik am, iskialf dereslam bezunel, kebahir iskebahir deres, kewenzem iskemitre darch aderes, yegezal, befitun Ethiopia, yesigdal, telat uchumma fer yelsalu. Yet Sesna, yet is Sait Och, Nigishtat, Sitotan, Teruma, in a Hebraist Kanka, Teruma, offering, gift, Sitotan, Yamitalu. Actually, Sitotan is the root is in the Hebrew. The word is sitota is in the Hebrew is teruma, but the root word of that is what was it? It was okay. We won't get into that because we kind of forgot. But it gave a sense of overcoming, of lifting up the eyes in victory. as did his majesty, as did Yeses, and he raised his, and he lifted up his eyes, you know, into heaven. And so the sense of victory, triumph, prevailing, overcoming, you know, I think it was Ruwa. So here we have, you know, bring gifts, you know, Negeshtat, Sitotan, Yamitalu, Yirubna Yisaba, Negeshtat, Eichi, Minshan, Ikerbalu, Negeshtat, Hulu, Yisigduletal, Ahizaban, Hulu, Yigizuletal, Chegrinyaun, Kek Emanyaw, Eichi, Retat Yelelewenem, Meskin, Yat Inuwalena, Lechegrinyan, Lemeskin, Yerara, Meskin, that's the poor, like Meskin, that's funny. So now, Yechegrinyoch Enem, Nefes, Yat Ena, Kekfina, Kechinket, Nefsachben, Yat Ena, Semach befitu kiburne irsu yenorale ke arbem wirke yesetut al uti zenavet irsu yetel yalu zevetrem ye barkut al bemidre usit beteraroj lai met egia yihunal freuen kelipanus yit ekef kefilal indemetre sharbeket ema Yipik lal, simule zalalim, buruk yehunal, kit ehayim ask et mo simu yenoral, yimitri ahizab hulu bersu yibarikalu, ahizab hulu yamisik nutal, which aun team ratn, yimiater ke yisrael, amlaka gziaber yibarik, yimiskanaun. Sima lealim mena, lezalalim yibariku, miskanawin, mitrine hulu yimla, yehun yehun, ye iese, lech yedawit mezmu, tefet seme, ye iese, lech yedawit mezmu, tefet seme. You know, it's a little longer than we had in mind, but you know, we give thanks, you know, first and foremost to the Most High God, Jah, and into His Christ, Yeshua, and we give thanks to all Rastafari. You know, we see the progress is coming together. You know, keep on going, keep it forward, keep it going. You know, so much things to say. Nonetheless, you know, we give thanks to all Rastafari. You know, just know for a fact that every little thing that we're doing is coming together and it's making a difference, you know. And so we give thanks for sticking through this reasoning. Shalom, Rastafari.